Hi, I'm Erica from FarmSteady, and today I'm going to be answering your most asked questions and giving you a primer on all things lacto-fermentation. This video is going to be a deep dive into exactly what lacto-fermentation is and how you do it. And if you're looking to dive straight into some fermented food recipes, check out this playlist. It's got some of our favorites. Otherwise, keep watching and we'll start answering your questions. Question number one. What are some lacto-fermented foods? The most common are yogurt, sauerkraut, kimchi, and naturally fermented pickles. These are things you probably have at least once a week. Other fermented foods that you know of are sourdough, vinegar, kombucha, but these aren't strictly lacto-fermented foods. They also are a combination of yeast and bacteria, so we're not gonna talk about them today. We're just gonna stick with the delicious world of lacto-fermentation. Question number two, what is the lacto and lacto-fermentation? Lacto is short for lactobacillus. And if you've ever heard of foods being really high in probiotics, really good for gut health, there's a really good chance that they're chock full of lactobacillus. What lactobacillus does is turn sugars into lactic acid. This makes things a little bit sour and also acts as a natural preservative, which is why when you're fermenting foods, the foods are fermented and don't, you know, rot like they normally would. Question number three, how do you add the lactobacillus to your veggies? So we often get asked if you have to add a starter, like when you're making sourdough, to make fermented vegetables. Best answer, no. Lactobacillus is actually everywhere. It's on the vegetables, it's on us, it's in the air. And now that I've totally creeped you out, I gotta let you know, it comes in peace. Lactobacillus is a friendly bacteria. So what we're really doing when we're fermenting foods is creating a good environment for that good bacteria to thrive. Question number four. How do you create a good environment for lactobacillus? Just like lactobacillus is floating all around us, other less friendly bacteria and yeast and molds are in the air as well. So the trick is to create an environment that lactobacillus likes and other things don't. We do that in two ways. One, by adding salt, and two, by keeping out air. Adding salt is super important to lactofermentation. Bad bacteria, the kinds that would spoil your food, can't handle a lot of salt, but lactobacillus can handle a little bit. So adding it creates an environment where the lactobacillus can really thrive and other things can't compete. Air, or oxygen, is something lactobacillus doesn't need to ferment. It's an anaerobic fermentation, so all the activity is actually happening below the surface, away from the air, and it keeps out kind of those molds and bacteria that would need air to do their work. If the top of your ferment is exposed to air, kind of mold and other grossies will settle there. That's why we use fermentation weights to keep everything kind of weighed down below the brine so that doesn't happen. Oddly enough, this is actually a point of contention because it's anaerobic. Anything under the surface is fermenting, so you don't actually have to have something totally weighing it down. It will still ferment, but it's going to kind of create a gross top layer. So if you're cool with open fermentations, you also have to be cool with like peeling off a layer of something kind of gross, which people are, and that's great. I'm not, so I choose my equipment carefully. Question number five, high five. What kind of salt should I use? Most important rule with salt is choose non-iodized. Iodine will kind of mess with your ferment, so don't use it, but kosher salt, sea salt, great. Question number six. Why do only some recipes call for a brine? So if you're looking at different fermented food recipes, you'll notice that while salt is always used, sometimes it's made into a brine and sometimes it's not. So what's the difference? Certain vegetables like carrots are really hard, and so rubbing salt on them isn't really going to do much. So with our lacto-fermented carrot sticks, that's something that we created a brine for. On the opposite end of the spectrum, vegetables with a ton of water, like cucumbers that you want to keep that liquid inside, those you do a brine so that you're not, so you're keeping them crunchy and not breaking down those cell walls and having all that water come out. The other way to add salt to your ferment is to add the salt and rub it in. The most common example of this is sauerkraut. So sauerkraut, you chop up all your cabbage, you sprinkle your salt on, you massage it, and that actually draws the water out and creates its own salty brine. Question number seven. Are all pickles fermented? This is a great question and something we get a lot because pickles are awesome and pickles are awesome. Unfortunately, no, not all pickles are fermented. Pickles that are in jars cut into spears or chips, those are going to be refrigerator pickles. And what I mean by that is they use a vinegar-based brine instead of fermentation to get sour. And when you're using a vinegar-based brine, you're normally, you're adding spices, you're often adding a little bit of added sugar, and while they're totally delicious, you're missing out on all that healthy and fun bacteria that you get from natural fermentation. Pickles, like you get from the deli that are whole, coming out of cloudy brine that you make yourself, those are fermented pickles and they're delicious. Question number 8. How do I get started and what should I ferment first? We make great kits at farmsteady.com. I designed them. It has my favorite fermentation weight ever, so I think that's a great place for you to get started. But if you have an old crock, if you have some jars, you can definitely start fermenting. As for what you should ferment first, do what you're most excited about. Pickles, fermented hot sauce, sauerkraut are all great places to start. Maybe don't choose something that has like a 3-month time before you get to taste it until, you know, your second or third batch. But otherwise, whatever you want to eat and are most excited about, that's going to be the best thing to ferment. Question number 9. How long do fermented foods keep? After you're done fermenting something, we tell you to move it to the fridge. What this does is slow down that fermentation. It doesn't totally stop it, so it's going, but at a very, very slow rate. Before your ferments go bad or mold, they're normally going to just get a little bit too sour or too soft and be unappetizing. So depending what recipe you follow, just look at the recommendation for when you should eat it by. Certain pickles, better within a week. Hot sauces do keep for months. Question number 10, your next question. We covered a lot in this video, but fermentation's a little bit weird and you might run into more questions, so please like this video, leave us a comment, and subscribe. Plus, we have loads more videos for kraut, hot sauce, pickled vegetables, kombucha, and more, and we'll keep these fermentation videos coming. Thanks so much for tuning in. So our favorite advice is eat what you ferment and then repeat. Then you're always trying something new, but hot sauces, those keep for months.